we mortify the works of the flesh by the Spirit. How? By thinking. Not by trying not to think fleshly, but by, here it comes, by the Spirit I mortify the deeds of the flesh. So it's not by trying to get rid of the flesh, it's overruling the flesh by the Spirit. So I take thoughts that are of a higher quality, a higher value, a higher standard, that's above.
The last
2 years, I was caught by the cancer sickness.
I
tried everything to be healed, but everything came to nothing.
I ended up at the hospital where they burnt my feet.
I ended up at the hospital where they bent my feet. If you could look well, then they had those, like the sores, they looked like grapes then. I got to the hospital, they kept on burning my feet, and then until my ligaments were now tight. I couldn't walk at all.
In the 20 toilet, Papa Mufumahadiwak.
For me to go to the bathroom, my father-in-law, a father to my husband, had to take me and put me on the toilet. And it was a disgracing situation. They came one day and my brother-in-law visited me. He advised me.
And then, kana go eo ke ile ka nka nthwana e bua ka matla mo dimo ke ile ka nka simple hampe.
When his brother-in-law told him about the power of God, I took it very light.
Go vitlela re hape ke kopane le Dr. Lidibane.
Until I met Dr. Lidibane,
then ke ene hapo ile a kenya moya o mokalo gore ke kgone go fitlha mo.
And he's the one who inspired me to come here.
Ke fa sware ga patla ipheta ka lefoko go nna.
And then my brother-in-law insisted again.
He took
out from his expenses and brought me here from Ventersdorp. When I got here in the auditorium, I've seated at the back from the third row from the back. When I was seated there, the prophet was busy teaching.
I was amazed
when he mentioned my situation. I asked, how did he saw me?
And
then he asked me all what you have just
seen.
The first time he talked to me,
I
felt something happening inside.
It was
the very first time I experienced
that. I
felt my whole body feeling warmth.
I couldn't
just hold myself.
But I just
pressured it and pressed that today I've got to see this.
And then he let
me stood at the center of the
eye.
He commanded me to look at him on the eyes.
Ka pelo e galetseng go fola.
With my whole heart desiring to be healed, I did just that. And he said a word in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Throw away those crutches.
And just as
as you were saying it, it was like I'm a robo man. Everything just took place automatically. I could just see myself going forward. I'm sure I took 3 steps forward. When I lifted my head up and looked at the prophet, I just saw the light around him. And then I was a little bit ashamed and closed my eyes.
I couldn't see that light.
I couldn't see the eye, for I had it like.
And
then he hugged me and put me on his chest. That's where I felt relaxed and experiencing this new life.
Thank you, Jesus.
Can you give us a fellow more game in Tonghore?
I was just asking myself one thing where I was standing. Where's my wife at this moment?
Fortunately,
fortunately, she was just after me.
Crying, weeping.
I think those
tears were tears of joy.
Hallelujah.
I plead with all those people who are sick in here. Open your hearts and your minds and accept the Lord and let this be clear that He is the only one who can save
Hallelujah.
Us.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. Wonderful.
The love of Jesus, people. Wonderful. The love of Jesus. Where's that lady with a short leg? Come, lady with a short leg. Can we have a chair quickly? One leg shorter, I think she was born like it. Now the one leg is deteriorating, it's getting thinner as well. The short leg is now getting thinner, and she said it's an embarrassment to her. She loved to wear dresses, now she wants to just wear trousers because she says she feels ashamed because of this leg, and she don't want to. God has made us better. Okay. So just lift up those legs so the people can see. Okay. That's a short one. Okay. It's much shorter. Okay. Now you want it to be well? Yeah, there it goes. Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
A renewing in these legs. Just stand up and walk a little and come sit down again. Now, just walk. Just walk and come sit down again. How does it feel?
I'm full right now. I'm healed.
Come sit. You feel you're healed. Sit nice, straight in the chair. And lift them up again. So we thank God for that perfection.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus, be totally restored in your whole being, and let your confidence and your boldness spring up like never before.
Amen.
In Jesus Christ. Be blessed.
Sure.
Awesome. Which
heart
is
failure and high blood.
And
pain
what?
Pull both legs and backache.
Pain in both legs.
Yes.
She can't stand for his own.
Can't she stand on her own?
Yes.
How did she come
she
here?
She can't walk a long distance.
How did you help her here?
I'm helping her. She's my mother.
Is she your mother?
Yes.
So she struggles to walk.
She's struggling when she's seated.
Die Here Jesus gaan jou gesond maak. Jy sal bly wees. Laat haar hart weer reg klop. Laat haar bene se pyn en swakheid weggaan. Laat jy lewe kan geniet. In Jesus naam. Okay, kom ons staan op. Hulle gaan jou help. Okay. Kyk vir my, dan gaan ons loop. Kyk vir my oma, die Heere Jesus Christus gaan jou gezond maak. En al die pijn en zwakheid gaan weg, dat jy weer lekker kan praat ook. Sal jy blij wees? Daar gebeurt die Marika. Kom ons loop. Ek het nou lang gesit, daar gaan ons. Velosa, kom jy gaan alleen lekker loop. Come, let's. She's gonna walk all on her own with a smile on her face. Come on, ma. Smile. Lekker. Say smile, ja. Hoe voel jy lichaam?
Huh?
Jy voel nou beter. Jy loop sonder hulp. Ons dank die Here dat jy heeltemal gesond is en nooit weer gaan sukkel nie. Nog goeie jare gaan sien. Jesus naam. Jy kan maar terugloop. You don't have to help her. Jy kan loop sonder hulp. Nee, jy gaan alleen loop, oma. Daar gaan jy. Alleenig. Daar gaan jy aangeen. Gaan jy aangeen. Halleluja. Halleluja. Do you think there's a difference? Do you think there's a change?
Yes, there is a change.
You had to help
her. She was unable to walk.
She was unable to walk like that. And now she's
walking. I usually
walking.
Assist her.
You usually assist her, now she's walking?
Yes.
Well, she's going to be fine. Bless God. Thank you, Jesus.
Let's join the service now as we listen to this life-changing word straight from the heart of God by Prophet Quibus.
Right, Romans chapter 8, I think we did this last night as well, but tonight verse 31, very well known scripture. What then shall we say to all this? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be our foe if God is on our side? So take it and make it your own promise tonight. He who did not withhold or spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also with him freely and graciously give us all other things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect when it is God who justifies? That is, who puts us in right relationship to himself. Who shall come forward and accuse or impeach those whom God has chosen? Will God who acquits us? Who is there to condemn us? Will Christ Jesus, the Messiah, who died, or rather who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, actually pleading as he intercedes for us? So God did not spare his own son, but he gave him up to die on that cross. Is that right? He says, if that wasn't too much for God, then what is too much for him? He didn't spare his son, but sent him to die on the cross. How much more will he freely give us all things? Now it says, if God has done that, now he asks, who can condemn you? Who can bring any accusation in against you? Who can say anything about you? God is for you. God wants to bless you. God wants to give you victory. God wants to lift you up. So you can just take it tonight. So there's the cross of Jesus Christ. Verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation. We started at verse 31. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son but sent him to die on the cross, how much more will he then freely give us all things? Who is there that can condemn you? If Christ died for you and is raised and is seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for you. Now he comes in verse 1. There is therefore no condemnation. We don't have to be condemned. Okay. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who live and walk not after the dictates of the flesh, but after the dictates of the Spirit. The Phillips translation says something to this effect. It says, who live not by the dictates of the flesh, but after the promptings of the Spirit. The Amplified says dictates of the Spirit and dictates of the flesh. The Phillips translation says dictates of the flesh, but the promptings of the Spirit. Your flesh will always dictate you and say, do it, do it, do it. The Spirit will just prompt you. Okay? So that is it. So for years we discussed it and we had many messages here on how do I walk in the Spirit? How do I get victory over the flesh? So tonight we're going to go a little bit deeper into that, and I think it's going to bless every person in the house. Verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life, which is in Christ Jesus, the law of our new being, has freed me from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law could not do. Its power being weakened by the flesh, the entire nature of man without the Holy Spirit, sending his own son in the guise of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, listen to this, God condemned sin in the flesh, subdued it, overcame it, and deprived it of its power over all who accept that sacrifice. He says, when the law was there, I could never do this. Because the power of the law, which works with the flesh, couldn't set me free so that I could walk in the Spirit. But now Jesus Christ came in the flesh and he condemned sin in the flesh by dying on that cross. So that now we can live after the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Because this law of the Spirit has set me free from the law of sin and of death for all who accept that sacrifice. Take it. I mean, we say Jesus died for me. Do we really accept it? Do we really live like the Son of God came from heaven, died for me on the cross, shed his blood, and in that dying, he did so much. But tonight, just one aspect. He condemned the sin that makes you to feel condemned. If you were here last night. So when I do something wrong, I feel condemned. That means I have not yet accepted the sacrifice by saying, forgive me. So if I accept the sacrifice, I can never live in condemnation. I accept it when there's an invitation. I accept it when the pressure is rough. But why don't I accept it 24 hours a day? Why do I live under condemnation if sin has already been condemned in the flesh by the Son of God dying on the cross? If I accept that sacrifice, I will then walk after the law of the Spirit of life and I will not be condemned. Just look again at chapter 7, verse 21, I think. Paul says, I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. Okay, I know you don't really feel like it often, but I have met a man that struggles with this thing. I live with a man. You know, many times he wants to do good and he finds that other thing present, you know, and I know a man. I lived with him for 52 years already. For I delight in the law of God of the inward man. Listen to verse 23. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. So I want you to just take notice there, because the church didn't see this for all the years. This law of the spirit of life, let's just put it there, the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus is the law of my mind. See, we didn't know how to explain spiritual stuff because we wanted to make it spooky instead of spiritual. So here the Bible comes. It says, when I want to do good, I find evil present. It says, there's a law in my inward man that wants me to do good. But there's another law in my flesh that wants me to do wrong. He says, so this law is fighting against the law of my mind, causing me to do the law of my members, and that causes me to sin. So sin is living after the law of the flesh, which is the law that was given to give sin its power. But there's another law, and you don't have to go to look deep for it. It's as close as your... So your mind is the thing that makes you think. So the spirit of life and the law of the spirit of life is as close as your thoughts. We try to make it so deep. But Kubus, isn't our thoughts our soul? That's exactly what it is. When God created man, he made him a living soul, not living spirit. He was a living soul because of the Spirit. The breath of God gives me life. Where? In my soul. Let's turn back to chapter 8, verse 4. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Come on, somebody need to see it. We've discussed it now over the last 3 months that we've made it difficult to walk in the Spirit when it's actually so easy. He says, now he says, those who mind fleshly things, think flesh is flesh. He who minds the Spirit, think spirit is spirit. So what makes you fleshly? Your thoughts. What makes you spiritual? Your thoughts. Can't you? There it is. He who minds the things of the Spirit, that equals life. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus works with the law of my mind. Chapter 7. So if I think spiritual, I am spiritual. If I think fleshly, I am fleshly. It's not how ghostly I look. Proverbs 23:7. For even as a man thinketh, so is he. Think fleshly, fleshly. Think spiritual, he's spiritual. As a man thinks, that qualifies. By which law are you living? The law of life of the Spirit in Christ, or the law of death, which is the flesh? But Christ already condemned that law. Condemned sin. Why do you want to then be in condemnation? God sent his Son to die on the cross. Will he not then freely give you all things? Who can condemn you? Condemnation robs you of getting all things. We discussed it last night. 1 John 3:20. Beloved, if your heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart. If your heart condemns us not, we have boldness toward God. And whatever we ask, we receive of him. Condemnation is the only source that robs you from getting. Okay, there's many byproducts like unbelief, but that all works with condemnation. Okay, chapter 8. Verse 13. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you, now listen, this is an awesome scripture. It's going to open up right now. If you, through the Spirit, do mortify the deeds of the body or flesh, you shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. That's one of the four times it's in the New Testament, sons. So by the Spirit, I mortify, I kill, I make dead the deeds, the dictates, the flesh. That's amplified. That's King James. I mortify the deeds by the Spirit. So, Quibus, how can I get victory over the flesh? How can I live after the Spirit? So I must take all the scriptures that we wrote, that we have written, that we have written on the board. Right. That we wrote on the board. If my thinking qualifies me spiritual, if my thinking qualifies me fleshly, then it means my spiritual thoughts mortify my fleshly thoughts, which mortify my fleshly deeds. You see, we have had a negative approach towards living in the Spirit. Our approach was rebuke, cast out, bring into subjection, bind the thing. And we had a negative approach where we were more fleshly conscious than spirit conscious. People had a negative approach towards living in the Spirit. So if a thought hits you, you come against it in a negative way. Because you think that is now evil. And then you bind it and you curse it. And you take it into subjection and you bring it into obedience. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 4 and 5. And I bind it and I say in Jesus' name. And then I try my best not to think. Not to think it. And the more you try not to think it, the more it comes back. So here comes a negative thought. It's flesh. Is it? Did I think it or did the thought arise? Come on, I want to help you tonight. Did I think it or did the thought arise? Where did the thought come from? Is it because I am unrenewed in my mind? What about this person that's always trying to please God in every area of his life? And all of a sudden the most wicked thoughts comes. Don't say no. Say yes. I know what I'm talking about. You can live the holiest life and you stand here. Where did this thought come from? Where did this thought come from? Yeah? Funny thought. Like here walks an old lady and you feel like, just put your foot in front of her and trip her. Like, what? So now I feel bad. Now I start not to think, oh Jesus, now I start repenting. For what? Have you sinned? And that's what we're going to touch on today. Have I really? Did I allow the thought? Was it a bombardment from outside? Wasn't the attack from Satan? Philippians chapter 3. Paul says in verse 10, I want to know him and the power of his resurrection. I want to get that resurrection power in my life. Verse 13, he says, I count not myself to have it already. But this one thing, Schultz, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I say we try not to think. That means I try not to remember. But you don't really get it right. So Paul says, but I forget it. I forget the things that are behind me. Yeah. Paul, how on earth did you get it right? Let's look at this. He says, I'm reaching out to what's ahead of me. Yeah. I'll just put some words in there. I forget that by that. Okay? I'll try and explain it in a minute's time. He says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Listen to verse 15. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect. Now we know perfect is sons of God. Sons of God, chapter Romans 8, verse 14, is they that are led by the Spirit. They are the sons of God. So sons of God is the people that are perfect. So if you want to be perfect, if you think you're perfect, you'll go towards perfection. This is what you do. Be thus minded. Your mind must forget what is behind, and your mind must reach towards what's ahead. Verse 16, nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as you have us for an example. So look for people who has the same mind. Look for people whose mind is filled with this stuff. Okay? Now verse 18, this is where I want to get to. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, they are the enemies of the cross. If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his son, but sent him to die on the cross. Remember where we started, and don't miss it. If Christ died on the cross, how much more will God freely give us all things? But it's only for those that will accept the sacrifice of the crucified Christ. For what the flesh could not do, and the law could not do because it was weak in the flesh, bringing me into condemnation, Christ made it possible by the law of the life, of the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. So now I can't be condemned anymore. No condemnation for those that are in Christ who live after the Spirit and not after the flesh. How do I live after the Spirit? By thinking spiritual. How do I live in the flesh? By thinking fleshly. So, we mortify the works of the flesh by the Spirit. How? By thinking. Not by trying not to think fleshly, but by, here it comes, by the Spirit. I mortify the deeds of the flesh. So it's not by trying to get rid of the flesh. It's overruling the flesh by the Spirit. So I take thoughts that are of a higher quality, a higher value, a higher standard. That's above. Okay, so Colossians 3 verses 1 through 3. If ye then be risen with Christ, set your mind and keep it set on the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. So I must think thoughts that are above, not high in heaven, above in standard, above in quality, and higher rank than that of the flesh. And that's how I mortify the deeds of the flesh, by thoughts of the Spirit. You may think it's nothing. I'm giving you a big mouthful now. We try a negative way to get victory, to live in the Spirit. No, it's mortify the flesh by the Spirit. So Paul says, you must look for people who's got the same mind, that forget what's behind, because they're reaching out to what's ahead, the spiritual stuff. He says, but I have warned you, there are people that will not mind this. They are enemies of the cross. It means they cross. They have not accepted the sacrifice. He's not talking about sinners. He's not talking about worldly people. He's talking about Christians that try to preach another type of gospel to give you victory by making you feel guilty all the time. Instead of making you feel good, you're a son of God. You're a child of God. You're washed in the blood of the Lamb. You are going to get the price of the mark of the high calling. Come on, somebody. So, it's not trying not to think it. Oh, God, forgive me. Oh, Lord, I'm going to get victory over these thoughts. Oh, Jesus, there I'm thinking it again. Oh, Lord, help me. Oh, here he kop for me. Jesus, help me with this head of mine. Oh, Lord. You pray that prayer. You've been praying it for 11 years. Oh, Lord, if I... Oh, Lord, I've done it again. You've not done anything. A thought arose. You didn't do anything. You are tested and tempted and tried in James chapter 1. So don't be double-minded when you are tested and tried in your mind. For a double-minded man gets unstable. So if I get a mind that's contrary to the mind of the Spirit, I mortify it, I kill it, I make it dead. Not by trying to get rid of it, but I kill it by the Spirit. Think of the house you want. Just think, my house will look like it. My car will look like it. Okay? Now say, I'm going to get it within the next 30 weeks. Now count the weeks. 1, 2, 3. See the weeks passing by. 4, 5, 7, 11, 3, 2, 8, 9. Count. Okay, look at me. Okay, count. Are you counting? All right, put your hand and say, hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Okay, how many of you are still counting? You're supposed to count till 30 or something. Are you still counting? So why did you stop counting? Because a higher law took over. The law of the mouth. For with the tongue confession is made unto salvation. Oh, come on, man. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It's a higher law. The mind must shut up when the mouth speaks. Try it. If you think I'm kidding. The mind stops every time the mouth speaks. Because it's subordinate to the mouth. That's why God said, let us make man. That's why God said, let there be light. That's why God said, let us make man in our image. That is why God said, that is why Jesus Christ is called the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and everything was made by the Word of God. It's the spoken Word. He carries everything by the power of His Word. They say God has got a word that's filled with power. Yes. So I walk and the thought comes. Uh-huh. So I, by church doctrine, say, I rebuke this evil thought. The devil says, I got him just where I want him. So the thought comes. I'm walking. I mean, I'm thinking spiritual. Oh, Lord, the meeting was so awesome. Oh, the anointing. Oh, when that guy got out of the wheelchair. Oh, gee. And all of a sudden, trip the old lady. Now, the first thing that comes to me is what I learned. I take this thought captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. I bind it. The devil said, who told you you got a thought? He said, I got him. I still got these thoughts. So, we're going to do it in the out of the word in a minute. So, here I walk. I'm just minding. Oh, it was awesome when that woman got out of the wheelchair. Now, here, trip the lady. I let the higher power take over. And I say, hallelujah, oh God, it was awesome when that woman got out of the wheelchair. Oh, blessed be Jesus. And I shut the law of my members, the law of sin and death. I cut it off by the law of the life of the Spirit, which is in Christ Jesus, by speaking creative, positive, powerful, Spirit-filled word.
Amen.
So Jesus comes and he says, the letter kills. John 6, 62, 63. But the Spirit gives life. The words that I speak, they are Spirit and they are life.
Amen.
That's why this ministry's name is Spirit Word Ministries. Philippians 3:19. 18 says, people who do not mind what I'm talking about today, they are enemies of the cross. The end is destruction. Mean death? They mind earthly things. But our conversation is in heaven. Come on, somebody. Who saw what I just read? He says, if people do not mind this, they are enemies of the cross because they don't accept that sacrifice. And they mind earthly things. That's where their mind is, on earthly things. It says they are living by the law of death and sin. So they live in constant condemnation because their mind is not set on higher things, reaching out things, spiritual things, above things. Peter, the rock, walks on water. You are the Christ, Peter, the rock. Who do men say that I am? Oh, some John the Baptist, others Elijah. Who do you? Oh, Peter, you are the Christ. Jesus said, Son of Man must be delivered over into the hands of the high priest to be crucified. Peter jumped up. He said, no way. Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. Whoa. From rock to Satan. I mean, I just got the revelation. Now I'm Satan. The same chapter. Two verses later. Why do you call me devil? Jesus said, because you mind earthly things. And your mind is not set on heavenly things. Colossians 3, what we quoted a few minutes ago. Set your mind on the things above and not on the things of this earth. So, where's your mind set? So, Philippians, Paul says, these people mind earthly things. That proves they are enemies of the cross. They don't accept the sacrifice. But our conversation. The King James is the only translation, I think, that says it. All the other translations have got other stuff in there. Our speaking is of a heavenly kind. So when it arises that there's a thought coming that's actually enemy of the cross, I conquer it by overruling it by a higher power that is speaking. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. So be quick to hear, slow to speak. For the wrath of man does not promote the righteousness of God, says James in chapter 1. Okay. Are we still there? Chapter 4. Oh, let's just do verse 8 and 9. For the rest, my brethren, finally, whatsoever is true, whatever is worthy of reverence and honorable and seemly, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely and lovable, whatever is kind and winsome and gracious, if there is any virtue and excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think on and weigh and take account of these things. Fix your minds on them. Verse 9, practice what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. What did we see of him? That to be thus minded. And listen to this, and model your way of living on it. And the God of peace, untroubled, undisturbed well-being will be with you. A thought is not in itself sin. And that's where Christians have missed it through the years. They think if a thought comes, they've sinned. And they stay under constant condemnation. Thoughts are arrows from the enemy's camp. And you are not exempted. That's why Paul says, I keep on stressing, I keep on pressing, I keep on reaching out. He said, we must just be thus minded. It's not that we have attained that victory, but we're going to press for it and go for it all the time. So stick with people that are thus minded. And if people are otherwise minded, they are enemies of the cross because they mind earthly stuff. So here comes a thought. When must I deal with it? When I have made it my own by meditating upon it. I'll show you how it works. Have you ever had a thought
And then you started writing the script of the movie of which the thought was the introduction. And then you become the script writer. And then you do the editing. You cut pieces out and you put pieces in. Then you present it and then you play the main role. And then the movie plays and you're the only one that looks. And before you know it, you're meditating. That is sin. Now you repent. You ask forgiveness. You rebuke, you curse it. And you still override it with the Spirit. But now you got to do something to accept the sacrifice of the blood of the cross that brought you the victory. You have meditated. Your thoughts were fleshly, so you are dying. So you must get back onto channel Spirit. So you start with a heavenly conversation. Father in heaven, forgive me for thinking this stuff. I ask that the blood of Jesus will wash my mind and cleanse it. Now I praise you. But better still, when the thought comes, don't make it sin. Don't write a script. Don't play the main role. Don't go and watch the movie. Let your conversation immediately become spiritual. So here comes a thought, whatever it might be. I don't care if it's just the thought of stealing a cookie or getting somebody else's wife. I don't care how small or how big. If the thought comes, don't color the picture in. Say, oh, bless you, Jesus. Oh, God, you are good. God, you are good. Hallelujah. Oh, God, you are good. Ba, 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 ba. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And the devil says, oh, your course is a god on a door. It's positive resistance. It's what you think. If you struggle to think, don't try not to think the wrong thoughts. Override it with your tongue. If you can't override it with thoughts, put your tongue with it. And say something like, hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, oh, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Oh, revive us again. James chapter 1, verse 21. So get rid of all uncleanness and rampant outgrowth of wickedness, and in a humble, gentle, modest spirit, receive and welcome the word, which implanted and rooted contains the power to save your soul, your thought life. Be doers of the word, not hearers betraying your own selves. If anyone listens to the word without obey, he's like a man who looks at his, carefully looks at his natural face. For he thoughtfully observes himself, then goes off and promptly forgets what he was like. But he who looks carefully into the faultless law of liberty, that's Romans 8 verse 3, and is faithful to it and perseveres in looking into it, shall be blessed.
Hallelujah.
In all his doings. Let the word, says Colossians 3 as well, dwell in you richly. So don't only listen to the word. Receive it. Let it be planted into you. It'll save your soul. For if you don't do what the word says, speak it, confess it, live it, you stay a natural man. You thoughtfully look in the mirror, the word. You think, You sit here and you say, amen. Yes. But when you walk out, you immediately forget. Why do you immediately forget? Because you didn't talk about it. Talk to 3-4 people about the message and you will not forget the message. When you go out, you say, oh, the word was awesome. What was it? Discuss it. That's how Yonggi Cho started his cell groups, by having his meeting repeated on Wednesday. So everybody had to study the message for Wednesday for the Bible study group and the cell groups. And they had explosion in growth.
But now we have meetings all the time with the Word. Just talk to someone. Say, yo, the Word, I tell you tonight. I tell you that Word, that Scripture, that thing about the cross. Say something to somebody. Make it your own.
Amen.
The Word. Be a doer of the Word. Is there in Philippians? Is there in James? Is there in Matthew 7, verse 24 and 25? He says, if anybody listens to my Word and do it, I will show you he is a wise man that builded his house upon the rock. And the storms came and the house could not fall because it was stable. So James 1, 8, if you are double-minded, you are unstable. So think God's thoughts. Walk God's ways. Mortify the flesh by the Spirit. In Jesus' name. What's wrong with you, sir? Arthritis. So Jesus Christ makes you well.
Amen.
All the pain and the weakness is leaving your body right now.
In Jesus' name.
Come, sir. Just stand up. Look at me. Look at me. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the pain and the weakness go. Walk. No more pain. No more weakness. And now, what's happening?
I feel difference in my body.
Yes.
Come, sir. Let's walk. Let's walk. Come. Bless you. Right, you can go. You're here. There's another living testimony.
Yes.
This man came in here, his leg was to be amputated. You've seen him before the service on the videos with all those braces in his legs. He came, a second time, and here he is perfected. No more braces. What happened to your leg?
I slept from my brother's kitchen door and got a fracture.
And you broke it?
Broke.
Doesn't it want to heal?
It's now 3 years that it's...
3 years?
It's really cost me a lot of frustration and it pestered with my mind.
Brother, Jesus Christ loves you so much. And he proved it by dying for you on a cross 2,000 years ago. Now let the miracle power of Jesus heal that leg. Everything that doctors try to do, and they just try to help, may God complete the work right now. How do you feel, brother? You can even move it?
Yes, now I can move it. I can feel recuperated at this juncture.
Huh?
Yeah.
Highly recuperated.
My goodness. Isn't that awesome? This man's leg had to be amputated. Was it 2 months ago? He was for an amputation of his leg. He came in here He was sitting there. I went over, took his crutches away from him. He's got steel pegs and stuff. They were going to amputate his leg that week. He came back the next week without the crutches. And here he is tonight without the braces. There's all the x-rays. Glory to God. Are you feeling fine? The pains. She was in a car accident. How long ago?
Yes. It's a car accident.
When?
Last of last month.
Last of last month. 2 months ago.
Yes.
And you had a lot of pain still.
Yes, I've got a pain before.
But now it's gone.
Yes.
And you don't have to walk with a crutch now.
No.
She came in with crutch. There she lying. That was all happening now while we were busy here.